could not stand. Ain't they feel about that crazy to go to me dead? Well, a little green man sings a real hell cat, rocking and rolling through the crazy flat. Brought out a sax and they started to blow. Brought out the drums and started to roll. My songs are rock and roll. My songs are rock and roll. I couldn't understand the thing they said about the crazy beat just stopping me dead.
Don't leave. Oh, start video? No, we don't want video, right? Stop. We just want to watch.
Well, I come out of hiding and started to rock. Little green man taught me how to do the bop. There were three foot high. They had a few bars. Brought it off and rolled all the way to the car. My songs are rock and roll. My songs are rock and roll. I could not understand.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming. Welcome to the High Bridge History Talk. This is sponsored by the High Bridge New Jersey Historical Committee. I'd just like to say a few words about the committee and High Bridge Borough and thank a few folks as well. I suspect that a lot of the people here are from High Bridge, but I know there's some people from outside, and we'll be talking a little bit about High Bridge just to put things in context, and maybe local folks will learn some stuff about that too. So High Bridge Historical Committee is a volunteer group. It's part of the borough government, sort of. Our mission is to promote interest and participation in the understanding of High Bridge local history. And High Bridge has a pretty rich history to promote, as local folks know. So we've been running talks like this for a few years, focusing on people and things nearby. The committee works pretty hard to try to maintain and preserve some of the important properties in town that most folks are aware of, including Solitude House, the Tisco Building, and Springside Farm. As many people know, this is a challenge given the limited resources available and the fact that we are volunteers. And of course, these days, the limitations on activity resulting from the pandemic. So I know a lot of people wish that a lot of things could happen, and we do too, and we try to make them happen and hope that other folks will help us going forward. We appreciate the support, the committee, that is. We appreciate the support we receive from the council. The DPW always helps us out with doing stuff over at Solitude and other places. And of course, other interested citizens. And just put in a plug regarding the latter. We're always looking for new volunteers, whether for individual projects or just ongoing support. There are lots of things to do. If you're interested in learning more and how you can help, please post to the chat and with your contact information, or you can send mail to events@highbridge.org. That's perfectly good email address. That was the one that was in the invite. And we'd love to have other folks join us. And then one other thing. So as I said, we're volunteers, and we get a tiny budget from the borough, and any other money that we have comes from donations. So back in the day, if anybody came to any of the live talks that we used to do downtown, we always had a little kitty there, and you could throw in a couple of bucks. And of course, we can't do that here. So please consider an online donation. I think Natalie's going to post the link to that again. It was in the invite. And we use any of those funds that we receive to support any other activities of these talks, and in particular, improvements to the properties. And more recently, we're trying to develop a collection of archives and artifacts to tell the story of Highbridge. So more on that soon. And by the way, if you're Highbridge, or even if you're not, and you have old photos or documents or objects that might help tell the story of Highbridge, we love to see and document them. Nothing is uninteresting. Like, even if it's, actually we have a bunch of Highbridge yearbooks, but, we like to know about, where people lived and what they did, and, did you work at Taylor Wharton, or maybe your grandpa did, and what did he do, and so forth. So, as I said, nothing's uninteresting. I'd like to thank some folks who helped get this going and who support the committee efforts in general. Our committee chairman, Nancy Hunt, a lot of people probably know her. Our committee liaison to the council, Natalie Ferry, of course, Mayor Michelle Lee, and my co-committee members, Kelly Maddos, Priscilla Rocky, and Jim Haar. I also wanted to thank some folks who shared their stories when I was trying to put this together, and who helped with some other research. So there's the ubiquitous Ozzie Goodman, that's probably a lot of people know him, Christina Whitted, Blaine Powers, Bill and Vicki Miller, who used to live in town, and their old gang up on Tisco Avenue, who let me bend their ear about this as I was learning about it. So a little bit about me. My wife Amy and I, we've lived in Highbridge since 2001. We moved here from Hoboken. I worked in New York and at Bell Labs as a research librarian. That's how I got interested in doing research. And currently work at the Institute for Electrical Electronic Engineers. I grew up in Morristown and Mendham when Mendham was a farm town. And I remember, like, when I was in high school, like, Highbridge was like the ends of the earth. I mean, when I first got a car, I remember, getting in and driving around and driving out here and like, whoa, what is this place? I'm really out in the country now. I vaguely recall hearing about Howard Menger in the 60s on the radio, because my brother had a shortwave radio and we just listened to the AM radio all the time, all over the country. And I'll talk about that in a little while. And like, Howard Menger was on the radio a lot. So when I got to town and I started asking around, I was kind of amazed that hardly anyone I talked to had ever heard of Howard Menger. So that's why I'm calling him a forgotten citizen, because it kind of seems like a lot of people, and of course, especially, relative newcomers like myself, nobody knows who he was and what his story was and, and what his place was, within the town. So that's what we're going to talk about. And I hope that folks enjoy it. So let's get going. So Howard Menger, there he is. I think he somehow took this picture himself. This is from a film. So Howard Menger, let's just get a little background on him. He lived in Highbridge for many years, between about 1949 and the early 60s. And he was famous. He was a famous guy in the media. And so what did he do? And why was he famous? Well, he claimed to have been in contact with extraterrestrials, who he said took him to the dark side of the moon. They revealed a lot of technology secrets and path to world peace and harmony. Sounds like a lot, but he's kind of been forgotten in local history. So who was he? And what was he like? Where did he live? Where did where did he say the aliens landed? And what did he say he did with them? How did his notoriety affect the town? So it's all, so like, why here? And why then? Why in the 50s? There he is. Here's Howard, a picture of him with his wife, Connie. Probably sometime in the mid-50s, probably, I figure it's probably about 56 or 57. He was described as a quiet, thoughtful, kind. He minded his own business generally. And by various accounts, he lost his home, his business, and was widely ridiculed for his stories. So what was his motivation? What was his place in the town, in the times? There are lots of conjectures and conspiracy theories, just like today. So I'm going to try to give a relatively even-handed description, and you can draw your own conclusions. So I'm just going to try to give just the facts. And by the way, I'm always looking for new facts. I'll say that again at the end. I would love to talk to folks in town or out of town who had any contact with him, or if, you know, your mom and dad or your grandmother and grandfather, you know, knew him or just, you know, tried to go down and look for the saucers downtown. You know, those are all good things to record for the history of the town. Okay. So what did he say? What did he say happened to him? So in a nutshell, between about 1946 and the early 60s, he recounted many stories of being contacted by good aliens. And they told him secrets about technology. They shared their benign philosophy, which they wanted him to help spread on Earth, to help humanity. And they had him help recruit or inform others of their presence among humans with the intent to help us evolve into better, higher beings. Right? Okay. So these are photos that he said he took from one of their landing spots, what he called, what they told him to call field location number one. Field location number one was behind his house, which was on the old Steinhauer farm across from Gronsky's. And actually the building that was his house still stands down there. It's down on the hybrid stone property. And so he, you know, this is an alien who kind of, he says, landed in his backyard, and there's one landing in the backyard, like, I guess, up on the hill there between the Highbridge Stone property and the golf course. By the way, so most of these images that I show, they're readily available. You know, pretty much everything I did, I found on the internet or in books. His books, a couple of them are still in print. Some of them are very rare, but there are at least a couple of them that are pretty easy to get online. I'm going to show them in a minute. And so these are pictures that are, they're in the books. So a little more about him. So he was a favorite on radio and TV at the time. He appeared on TV shows like The Tonight Show, the early Tonight Show, when Jack Parr and Steve Allen were the hosts. This would be about 1956. He was on the Today Show. He was on the Long John Nipple radio show. That's here he is here. That's him right there. There's Long John Nipple. Long John Nipple was a late night radio host on WOR. I think that's where I heard about him when I was probably in about fourth grade when I first moved to New Jersey. He was kind of like, if you ever listened to Art Bell on AM radio, you know, who I think Art Bell just passed away about a year ago, but he was, you know, he was a, you know, a radio host who was, he was on all across the country, you know, on hundreds of stations, and he was all about telling conspiracy theories and stuff about whatever. So Long John Neville was a lot like him back in the day. He was featured in the New York Daily News, the New York Times, papers all across the country. He went across the country. You can see this one here. Here's a clip from the New York Daily News in 1959 of a meeting in Yucca Valley, California. And I found lots of other clippings like this, but from local papers all across the country, similar kinds of meetings of people who believed in flying saucers and so forth. So he was kind of everywhere. The last time he was interviewed in the New York Times was about 1996. He said the saucer that I saw land in Highbridge was only about 40 feet across. It made no noise and had no exhaust fumes. The EPA would have loved this craft. Here he is on the radio. Here he is at a big meeting that he and his wife ran actually in Lebanon. You know, you can see that's an NBC radio microphone. So, you know, being broadcast, he had a way of telling what happened to him, and his honesty or way of phrasing things made him, sadly, kind of a laughingstock. He was often ridiculed by the hosts, and it seemed that many times he didn't catch on that the questions asked of him were made to make him look comical. During the interviews, he always was forthcoming as he could and was trying to get his version of the truth out there. But it seemingly didn't realize that people either weren't believing him or they're just laughing at him. He was a sign painter. He had a business as a sign painter. He had a shop up in Washington. And along the way, you know, over these years, despite his notoriety, he lost a lot of his clientele due to what he was saying. People didn't want to hire him because he was telling his wild stories, and he eventually lost his house and his business. Sometime, I haven't been able to figure out exactly when, sometime in the early 60s, he moved to Florida. He and Connie moved to Florida. Maybe some locals can fill me in on that. So simply put, his personality is in how he communicated was sometimes very humorous, and he wasn't trying to be funny, but his mannerisms and descriptions were seen by many as sort of comical. So just a little, keep that in mind as we're talking about what he said happened. So here are some of his publications. So this one, From Outer Space to You, this one is was his really kind of the core book, which was published like at the time in the, I think about 1956. Actually, I have it right here. I can tell you. It's got a copyright date on it, 1959. And this is a painting, like the cover is a painting of his that is describing his initial encounter with one of the aliens. And so here's this beautiful woman. I'm going to read this in a second. And then this right here is a silhouette of himself. And so this is supposedly happening on the farm up there off of 513 across from Grotsky's, like up on the hill. I guess the golf course would be back there someplace. But this is field location one. So this book, it has really the core of a lot of his stories that he was recounting, you know, over time. And then this book, which came out in the 70s, really is kind of a, I don't know if you'd say it's a rehash or like a rehash and sort of in his mind, like a clarification of a lot of the stuff that he initially reported in From Outer Space to You. Because over time, you know, people sort of called him on some things, and he changed his story a little bit. This book, actually, for folks who live in Hunterdon County, this book is in the county library, and you can take it out. Now probably everybody's going to go there and try to take it out. But this book, The Fembra Outer Space to Do, you can get this on Amazon. That's where I got a copy. I'm sure an original, like a hardcover copy, is, you know, probably hundreds of dollars. This book is pretty rare. This is from the 90s, and after they moved to Florida and were, you know, they've sort of became new age darlings. And it's, he described it as further secrets of the philosophy of the benign aliens. It's a very, very rare book. Actually, the last time I looked it up on Amazon, somebody was asking like $400 for a copy of it. This, which we'll hear later, this is a record album that he made, in the mid 50s. Very rare, but you can find the recordings on YouTube. That's where I got them. And we'll talk about this a little later. He said that before he recorded this record, he was not musical and he didn't play the piano. And that's what it is. It's piano music. And he claimed that it was dictated to him by extraterrestrials. So there you go. You can see, like, that's kind of his standard portrait. There's Connie. There's that alien picture from Field Location 1, a couple more of those there. So just a little more background on him. So he was not an abductee. If folks like listen to, you know, or any kind of flying saucer lore, he was not an abductee, he was a contactee. So what that means in UFO lore is there's a difference. So contactees usually told stories about benign aliens, like these are the good aliens who were trying to help us, right, and teach us things. And abductees, they're the ones who, you know, told about, you know, evil aliens who wanted to take us over, and the people that got experimented on and so forth. So you need to keep that in mind again when you understand the stories that he was telling. And so more, a little more bio. So my friend Bill Miller found this. This is actually a birth record, census act, showing, like, there he is, Howard Menger, born on West Street, it says. It's hard to read, but anyway. So he's born in Brooklyn, and he lived in Cliffside Park. Born in Brooklyn in 1922, lived in Cliffside Park for about 10 years. And then in 1932, his parents moved to Highbridge. And that's where he had his first contact in the woods behind, you know, across from Gronsky's. So I'm just going to read a little bit. This is from Outer Space to You. One day in 1932, when I was 10, I saw something more beautiful than the surroundings. There, sitting on a rock by the brook, was the most exquisite woman my young eyes had ever beheld. I halted in my tracks, and my breath stopped. She turned her head in my direction. Even though very young, the feeling I received was unmistakable. It was a tremendous surge of warmth, love, and physical attraction. And she said, and it goes on for a long time, but she said she knew where I had come from and that what my purpose would be on Earth. She and her people had observed me for a long time and in ways I would not quickly understand. When she spoke of her people, I still could understand that they were from another planet. As I listened in awe, my eyes delighted in feasting on the beauty of this lovely creature. She pronounced my name and reassured me she knew who I was from a long, long time. And then some words that I've taken on even more joint meaning as I've grown older: we are contacting our own. So right away when he was 10 years old, this beautiful blonde woman in a silver jumpsuit that we saw on the cover of that book was telling him that he was kind of a chosen one, that he was going to help the benign aliens. Let's see, further bio. So he went in the army. Actually, before that, he while he lived in Highbridge, you know, he was probably, I guess, in his 20s. He worked at Picatinny Arsenal. Folks know where that is. And he was a map maker and a draftsman. So it sort of makes sense that later on, he became an artist and a sign painter. So this right here, this is out of the directory of Washington from about 1959. And it's kind of hard to read, but it says Howard Menger signs, truck lettering, show cards, artwork, Port Colden, New Jersey. So if you know where that is, it's a little bit up Route 57 from Washington, but that's where his shop was. But when in his books, he talks about living in Washington. So that'd be, you know, in the 50s. Picatinny Arsenal, yeah, 1941. So during the war, part of the war. Then he was in the army. He was in a flame-throwing tank battalion, yikes, on Okinawa. If you know about that, that was a brutal campaign. And he tells the stories about being contacted by other benign aliens while he was in training in Mexico. And so a common thread of a lot of these contacts, they're pretty much all of them are that he describes as people being tall and blonde and attractive and, you know, statuesque. What actually, you know, some people would describe as like Aryan, which is a little odd. And again, they told him that he had been chosen, he was being watched, and that more contacts would come. So that happened a couple of times while he was in the army. Once, while he was on Okinawa, where supposedly one of these aliens sort of saved him from being captured by the Japanese. And anyway, so then he comes back to, you know, survives the war, comes back. So from about 1946 to 56, he had this sign painting business up in Washington. That was where some of his early, you know, further contacts with the aliens at where the saucers actually came down. So there's a couple places to know about there. Well, we'll talk about in a minute. Then after about 1956, from 56 to 62, 63, that's when he lived in Highbridge, pretty much full time on West Main Street at, you know, right here. Here's the house, field location number one, what's now the Highbridge Stone property. So take a drive by there and take a look. All right. So I want to say a few things about Highbridge in the 50s, just again, to put a little context around this. I love this picture. It's like, seems like it's right about now. But in, I don't know what year is this. I think that's a 54 Chevy, maybe. Other people probably know better than I do, but that looks like this is about 1955 or 1956. So again, for folks that are not from the area, and I know there's few online, so thanks for coming. And maybe for some folks who lived here now, just wanted to talk a little bit about Highbridge at the time. So Highbridge is a borough in northwestern New Jersey, about 55 miles west of New York City, 25 miles from the PA border at the Delaware. It's in a semi-rural area of the New Jersey Highlands on the south branch of the Raritan River. Right now, we have a population of about 3,500 It's mostly residential, and there's a medium-sized steel factory in the middle of town. There's been one there since at least the 1870s, which, you know, folks here, of course, you know, you hear it from time to time. And so, well, today, you know, it's a quiet sort of semi-suburban town. You know, it's the end of the New Jersey Transit, Raritan Valley train to New York. That's a few miles off 78. But at the time of these events, Highbridge was a pretty busy place. It was probably, I don't know, I'd call it like a potpourri town in the 50s. Still is a little bit. But it was basically a one company industrial town in the middle of mostly farmland. Taylor Wharton Iron Steel, the plant that today houses Custom Alloy, was a big operation, dominated life in Highbridge. There were three shifts going most of the time. Taylor Wharton manufactured heavy steel products like railroad track switches, tank treads. They made the treads for the space shuttle transporter at Cape Kennedy, dredge buckets for gold mining machines in Alaska. We've got one of those down in Shopee, and maybe you've seen it at events. Excavator buckets for huge steam shovels, including those that built the Panama Canal. You know, so it's pretty heavy industry. And, you know, a lot of guys working hard on, you know, on hard stuff. It was mostly a working class town, and there was probably activity pretty much 24/7. You can imagine during World War II and good economic times, it must have been loud and smoky. Remember that everybody had, you know, pretty much had a coal furnace, and, you know, the factory was hopping. There were at least two other small factories in town, mostly supporting Tisco, including Exact Level and Tool, which, you know, those buildings are still down across from the municipal building on 513. There's a couple other little tool factories over on East Main Street. The railroad, the CNJ Railroad, ran commuter and long distance services operating on what's now the NJT line. Freight in and out of Taylor Wharton and the coal and lumber dealer, two coal and lumber dealers. You could get on a train in Highbridge and go to New York or Scranton or Points West. And long freight trains ran up what's now the Columbia Trail, like two or three, four times a day. With what's now the Commons was a big switch yard. Tisco had its own railroad that ran through the middle of town and crossed Main Street, across a trestle on McDonald Street and along the ridge above the playing field. You can see some of the tracks are still in the pavement down by the Tisco building and in the alley next to Circa. So, like, imagine this picture, like, you know, we're right about here where this truck is, right about there where this guy's walking, right? That's the tracks. There's railroad tracks going across the road there. Imagine what it was like to have to stop and wait for a train to cross in front of Circa. And then up here where this car is, that's up by the Commons, like that was an active freight railroad. You know, you had to stop for, you know, a 30 car freight train. You know, things were different. there were a lot of other smaller businesses and grocery. Circa was a grocery, there was a bank and a theater next to where the liquor store is now, pharmacy, here's a soda shop, here's one of the three, or maybe it's four, gas stations. Here's a bar, now I forget what this is called, somebody will remind me. You know, what's now Scouts was a bar. There were at least a couple other kind of rough and tumble bars, you know, including what's now Mrs. Riley's. They were open most of the time because all these guys were working in the factory, you know, three shifts. And, you know, other towns were also pretty busy. Washington also had a number of factories and active rail line. But meanwhile, the surrounding area was pretty rural with farms and fields and hills and so forth. And a lot outside of town, it was, you know, so the town itself was pretty busy, you know, a lot of the time due to Taylor Wharton. But outside of town, it was probably a lot like it is today. It was quiet and it was dark at night. And remember that there was no Route 78, no Route 80. There was 22, 46, Route 31 was kind of unimproved. There was no Round Valley Reservoir, no Spruce Run, you know, so we were, you know, hybrids kind of out there, but it was, you know, self-contained, you know, active. So keep that in mind when you know, we start talking about what, you know, what Howard Menger said he was seeing. This is just a, you know, here's a shot of the interior of Taylor Wharton, you know, with one of the giant machines. That one could still be there. I don't know, for all we know, it might be computerized now probably. But you can see it's pretty heavy industry, you know. Here's Exact Level and Tool, you know, with a company concert sometime in the 50s, like when that building was active. And then just back to the railroad. So here's a picture of, this is what it was like. I mean, this is as late as 1974. Here is a giant freight train with 1, 2, 3 locomotives about to cross Route 513. And over here, this is the Commons, which was a, you know, big freight yard before it was a park. So, you know, a lot of stuff going on here. It's a, 72. Whoops. I'm putting in a plug because I'll probably do another talk about the railroads in town at some point too. So just to keep that in mind, you know, what a busy place Highbridge was. All right, now a little more now about, so where did he live, and you know, what was his kind of place in the town? So where did this stuff happen? So you know, as I said, West Main Street, the Steinhauer farm across from Gronsky's. So these are a few pictures. These are from his book. And according to him, these three folks here are aliens, which, you know, taught him things. But they're sitting outside his house. And here's the house. And this is Marianne Tharp. Maybe some folks know her. Older folks might know her. Who was a babysitter for him and Connie. Now I looked at this picture, and when I was trying to figure out where he lived, just to kind of confirm where it was. So I don't know, this is kind of hard to see, but so here's that picture again. So I looked at some topo maps and some other photos to just try to figure out, like, so where is she sitting? And what is she looking at? So if you look pretty closely, like here's the Reformed Church, and here's the steeple of the Methodist Church, which is getting worked on right now. And here's the railroad station. And so I kind of figured that this is like Dennis Avenue, and maybe this is Ridge Road, and this looks like Sylvan Avenue. So this is kind of like the beginnings of the development of Jenny Jump. Right. And then so 513 or Main Street would be down here, you know, and Gronsky's is probably just off the screen a little bit. And you can see, you know, we're looking northwest, like going up towards the gorge over here. Okay. So just to put a little perspective on where this stuff happened. All right. So he was famous. So for what? What happened? What did he say? Right. We saw this one and this painting. This is one of his paintings of his encounter with aliens at field location number 2, which we'll talk about that in a second, where that was. But and this is photo supposedly taken from the backyard at West Main Street. So what happened? What did he say happened? Right. So these are the primary contacts that he talks about in the books. You know, the first one I already talked about, where he, you know, the beautiful woman meets him in the, you know, he's about 10 years old in the backyard there. and tells him that he's chosen. You know, over time he claimed he had, you know, multiple contacts with these aliens. He initially thought they were from the planet Venus, but later corrected that in the second book and said they had stopped at Venus on their way here from their origin planet, which he'd never learned. So he was one of the primary voices of what you know, gets called the contactee, as I mentioned earlier, or space brother movement, wherein people like George Adamski, he was another of the early contactees, were routinely visited by these benevolent non-terrestrial beings. They called these space brothers, they sometimes called them Orthons, and supposedly have appeared throughout history on mountaintops and deserts, and they walk on water, fly in the sky. And the contactee is a sort of psychic lightning rod who's highly susceptible to receiving their psychic messages. He tells many stories of where he, like when he was in the army, where, you know, he's walking along the street in Mexico someplace and somebody's talking, he's hearing somebody talking, but nobody's talking. So it's, you know, he's being contacted psychically. So these Orthons will plant ideas and stories into the minds of the contactees as a seed to spread the ideas to the rest of humanity. So these ideas are meant to provide a helpful like cultural message. And Orthon, that sort of comes from this other guy, Adamski. He was another contactee that Menger was close to. That Orthon was the name of a space brother that he met. So over time, Howard Menger, he started to believe that the truth about the alien messages was being covered up for political, religious, and scientific reasons. You know, the political, the power of the aliens was too much for the average person to understand. It was kind of too scary. Religious, you know, seems kind of obvious. It would be subversive to some religions. And scientific, because the technologies were too powerful to be widely shared and with governments. But later on, he said that it was actually the government that was preventing this message to get out. So back to this, here's chronology. So I made a map of, these are, as I said, you know, different events that that supposedly happened over time at all these different locations. And they're all around this area. So let's see, I think the next thing, yeah. So here are those places. If we go back here, you can see there's High Bridge Field location number one. That's, we know where that is. Pleasant Grove, you talked about Pleasant Grove, but it's not exactly clear where that is. There's two Pleasant Groves in this area, Pleasant Grove Road. There's a Pleasant Grove Road up in Long Valley. I think that's field location number two. He tells a story of being taken up there from his shop by two aliens, and that's where he goes for his first ride in a flying saucer. Somewhere, seems like it's somewhere up near Point Mountain, or like up on the mountain there. In 1950, his brother-in-law says that he saw one of the saucers explode above field location number two, somewhere off the route, like his brother was driving on old Route 24, it's now 513. So that sort of seems to confirm that maybe it's up there on the mountain, you know, Schooley's Mountain, Long Valley. Then he goes to all these different places with these two guys, who identify themselves specifically as Martians. They pick him up at field location two and they take him out to lunch. in Easton at a cafe that was on the circle at the time. And they reveal some secrets to him. This is while he was living in Washington. And then in 55, he moved back to the homestead in Highbridge. So then a lot of the other stuff, the key events supposedly take place there. So the picture taking, the saucer ride, they take him for a ride from field location from right down on Main Street. And then also from up on Pleasant Grove, takes more pictures. They're always kind of encouraging him to take pictures. Over time, he sort of becomes, he's almost like a concierge for the aliens. Let's see, I think I've where he actually talks about how more and more, there's a chapter in From Outer Space to You where he describes himself as the barber, the barber to the space people. Many of my contacts were of strictly mundane nature, actually helping them in little material ways. I often purchased clothing and took it to points of contact. Visitors just arriving from other planets had to be attired in terrestrial clothing so they would pass unnoticed among people. So he talks about that quite a lot, and he tutors aliens in current slang so they don't stand out. So at one point, he's in his shop and an alien calls from the Fountain Motel. We all know where that is. They're showing him all these amazing things. This all sort of culminates in August of 1956, where they contact him again, and he goes out to the Blue Mountains in Pennsylvania, and they take him on a ship to the dark side of the moon, which he has many photos of and descriptions of in his books. So a lot to take in, and all of this is in his books. So here are those places. So, you know, here's Highbridge, just to show you that he's, you know, kind of around this whole area, all these things are supposedly happening around here. There's Highbridge. I got this wrong. This should be somewhere up here, like in around Long Valley. That's field location number two, somewhere over there. That's actually Pleasant Grove Road. And then here's Washington. And so it's Port Colden's like around here someplace. So, you know, that's probably where his shop was. And then these couple of other odd events took place in Plaquemine, which involved actually some local law enforcement here in Highbridge. Chief Kice, I think it was his name was. I'm going to take a little talking break here and show you this. This is a film supposedly taken at field location number one on West Main Street. So see what you think about this. Doesn't seem to be going. Oh, there it goes. Not sure why there's a shadow. This video is, by the way, is like readily available on YouTube and other places online. So you can go find it yourself. I'm sure a lot of people are thinking what maybe that looks like, but not going to watch the whole thing. Then these are photos also taken. You see that field location number one. So here's this about 40 feet up landing on West Main Street, somewhere like right back there across the street from Gronsky's. And then he tells the story that in this extraterrestrial woman she's just touched this invisible control on her belt, and she's about to disappear and be teleported back into the ship. Okay. And, you know, although these are fantastic stories, in the books he describes his regular mission for the aliens, you know, and they're like, this is just sort of, he gets used to this, you know, to these experiences. And in meeting other people through the aliens who are also contactees. So that's another interesting thing about this is that, you know, there's a lot of other people. Well, number one, you know, there seems to be a steady stream of aliens coming down because he's constantly being called to get clothes for him or to teach him how to talk correctly and how to blend in. So there are a lot of aliens walking around. And similarly, every once in a while, they introduce him to somebody else, another human who's like him, you know, or maybe has a slightly different mission. So, you know, it's an interesting, you know, kind of secret conspiracy that all this is going on. And, you know, most people don't know. But it sort of begs the question of, well, where are all those aliens? What happened to them all? You know, are they still here walking around? Like, where are all the people that knew about this? You know, are they still here? So something to think about. This is actually sort of a rehash of what I was talking about, that this woman that he met in 1946, but later now, like 10 years later, in 1956, she reappears coming out of one of the ships at field location one. Okay, yeah. Then, yeah, he tells this story of being taken up to the Poconos and gradually taken on a trip to the dark side of the moon. And this is a picture of a saucer coming in to land at the dome, one of the domes on the dark side of the moon. Here's where they took him. They met him at Besseker's Family Diner on Route 209. I think it's still there, actually. It's up near Stroudsburg. It's where he and the aliens met before the trip. They left from Mount Effort, which is up in the Blue Mountains, up north of there. So two trips to the moon, according to him. Let's see, maybe I'll read a little of that. He says, we drove Route 15 toward Mount Effort. When we approached the Blue Mountain area, we turned off onto a dirt road. And I recognized a familiar spot. I remembered that a transmitting instrument had been placed there some time ago. The alien friend got out of the car to inspect the instrument. Then we got back in the car and followed another car until it pulled onto a dirt road. We walked toward a smaller craft. By the time we reached it, let's see. He gets in the craft and they head to the moon. Nine people, eight at a table and one at the controls. I asked how fast we were going. The pilot told me 82,000 miles per hour. We will decrease or increase as speed according to the density of the meteor shower ahead of us. So detailed explanation of that in From Outer Space to You. Now I want to just talk about like some of these, like why is this happening at this time? And, you know, why are the stories, like, they're all very consistent, again, by the, you know, the contactees, that they all seem to be kind of the same. So these are the people we saw in that other picture, supposedly three extraterrestrials, Jill, Don Thor, and Valiant Thor, who said they were from the interior of the planet Venus. And this picture is taken at the house. It kind of seems like, you know, a lot of cultural historians will talk about this, about how, like, the aliens, these contactee aliens might have been partially inspired, or the concept of them, by the movie The Day the Earth Stood Still. If you've never seen it, it's well worth seeing. Michael Rennie, and that's, of course, Gort. Oops. Gort. Klaatu Ra Dinicto. Probably heard that. In the movie, this extraterrestrial arrives on Earth to warn humanity about the dangers of atomic weapons. And they shoot him, and things don't go well. Some cultural historians describe this as like a living myth, and that among believers, the Nordic aliens, like these guys, are often associated with spiritual growth and love, and act as protectors for the experiences, which certainly is what you hear, you know, you read Howard Menger describing. They're often described as benevolent or even magical, and again, his stories, you know, follow that, who want to observe and communicate with humans and are concerned about the Earth's environment and prospects for world peace. We already talked about how they have telepathic powers. They're paternal and watchful and smiling and youthful. Common thread there with a lot of these descriptions. So what was it about the times that contributed to this? I'm calling it a mania, but, you know, this was a common thread in the 50s, that lots of stories like this. You know, I already described, like, all these different meetings, you know, on the radio, everybody was interested in this. So what was it? You know, why did this happen at this time? So, to me, it's possible that maybe advancing technology was changing society. And, you know, was it all for the good? People didn't know. And then why did it stop? You know, maybe the reality of the modern world took over. But if you think about it, you know, after the war, which is when a lot of this is happening, all through, you know, from the late 40s into the early 60s, you know, there were some huge leaps in technology. You know, you had, you know, science was scary. You know, you had the bomb, the atomic bomb after, you know, World War II, and then the hydrogen bomb, early computers, people didn't understand. You had missiles, you had V2 rockets in World War II, you know, and the other, German terror weapons, what we call them today. And then right in the middle of that, you know, the space race was happening right in the middle of you know, Menger's rise, Sputnik, you know, was launched, the first satellite. And that was scary. I remember when I was a kid, my parents, like, waking my brother and I up out of a sound sleep to go to carry us into the backyard so that we could see Sputnik going over. And that was scary. Everybody thought that the Russians were going to drop a bomb on us from space. So all through this period, you know, there was a lot of technical change. You know, Sputnik, the space race, the bomb, the Cuban Missile Crisis, you know, the transistor was invented during this time, nuclear power, big science, the laser was invented in, you know, 1957, integrated circuit 1958. So, you know, a lot of stuff happening. You know, again, like, there's a V2 rocket, you know, here's Hiroshima, Nagasaki, this is a British radar, you know, like what was radar, you know, and what's a computer? What is this stuff? You know, it was almost, you know, too much, you know, for a lot of people to digest. And, you know, so what caused this then translation of all that information into this stuff? I think I was playing this record when we were, you know, starting up, you know, Flying Saucer Rock and Roll. And, you know, like, here's all the saucers, right? I think I had this model in 1957. You know, in the 50s, you know, that this kind of tech, it was sort of fun. And the United States went through this period of popular belief in flying saucers and stuff, you know. But then, you know, this stuff happened, you know, and maybe it wasn't so fun anymore. But, you know, Highbridge was kind of at the center of this mania with Howard Menger, because everybody knew who he was. And so to me, the question is, like, which one came first? Was Howard Menger, like, or the outside world? You know, I suspect they probably fed on each other, you know, that, you know, he, you know, remember that, you know, he was kind of a tech guy. He worked at Picatinny Arsenal, you know, he knew about electronics and stuff. And so, you know, he was probably aware, you know, of a lot of the technology of the day. Why did he translate it into this other stuff? We don't know. And why here? Like, he sort of took advantage of it, it seems like, at least that's what some people say. All kinds of local people seem to become believers. If you look on online, there's a very interesting documentary from a local TV show. It's probably from the 70s, where a lot of local people are interviewed, including Mrs. Gronsky, who has a kind of wry perspective on this, in my view. It's worth looking at. But in this film, there's a local psychiatrist, there's a newspaper reporter, a bunch of regular folks, like, and some of them seem to believe some of this stuff because other people did, you know. And other people were like, well, who is this guy? And, you know, what is he talking about? You know, I talked to a gentleman whose father was a farmer over in Lebanon. And he told stories of people hiking up to Hell Mountain, if you know where that is, up off of Rockaway Road, with coolers full of beer, you know, in the middle of the night, just waiting around. Like, why? And, you know, they were waiting for the saucers to come. And I said, well, did he really think they were coming? And he said, well, some people did, you know, but it was something to do. You know, it was a cheap place to go on Saturday night. You make out, drink some beer. You know, I never saw nothing. but so, you know, the Mengers, it seemed like they sort of took advantage of this. This is a picture of them at both of these at a 1958 East Coast spacecraft convention that they held in Lebanon. You know, and again, here he is on NBC radio, apparently live. And other local Highbridgers have told me about crowds of people, like, getting off the train when the trains ran on Saturday and Sunday, when you could take the train from Jersey City out here, people would take the train on a Saturday or Sunday, and like a crowd of people would be walking down Main Street to Menger's house to sit around and listen to him tell stories about this. So some of the people that, you know, that are named in his books and correspondence, like, they're, you know, people around here. And again, some of the people I've talked to, some people thought he was a total crackpot, that he was a real estate scammer. So one person said, he always walked around town dressed up in nice clothes. This was a working class town, and some folks thought he was acting stuck up and too good for us. So draw your own conclusions. Now, I said, this is a blank, but I'm gonna play this. So this is, I showed that picture of his record album. And he told this story of driving, sort of being on in this sort of trance and driving up to the Hudson Valley, not knowing where he was going, and then ending up at some little house somewhere, and there was a piano there, and they dictated this music to him. Here's his voice.
The song from Santa, as it is played by me while my fingers are guided by this strange force. I have also been instructed to tell the people that those hearing this music would get the feeling, would reach an awareness. It would act as a mental assist to release something from their subconscious, and it would react in their conscious state with understanding and spiritual love for each other, for mankind on this planet Earth. Now you may listen to the song from Saturn. Thank you.
Could have faded out. So sounds a little bit like Chopin, like little sort of fractured Chopin or Schumann, if you know classical music. But interesting, right? It's like sort of proto New Age, you know. And I mean, this record came out in 1959, I think. So kind of interesting. And that's about what I've got. So I'm sure people have questions, and so do I. like what happened to him? What happened to Howard Menger? He retired, sort of retired to Florida in 1962. Some people say he was sort of run out of town in some kind of shady real estate deal. I haven't really been able to get any details on that. So if anybody knows, I'd love to find out. In 1965, when kind of nobody except like real crackpots believed him anymore, by that time, everyone understood that the surface temperature of Venus is, 400 degrees centigrade, and there's no atmosphere on the moon. He stated on television that he had actually never met the extraterrestrials, and that all the encounters, including those in Highbridge, were staged by the U.S. Secret Services to test the psychological reactions of people to possible extraterrestrial visits. How about that? And then you know, they retired. He and Connie retired to Florida, and they no longer really talked about their Venusian friends until 1991, when they published the other book, which is, again, recounts the, you know, returns to his earliest claims and stories, asserting that they were, you know, all these encounters with extraterrestrials were entirely real. So, so the other question, like, did he profit from this? It's unclear. You know, he must have made some money on appearances and book sales and stuff. He traveled all over the country, so, you know, and he was on TV and stuff. Presumably he got paid for that. But he, you know, gradually neglected and apparently ultimately lost his business. He continued research into, you know, various, some of the technologies that supposedly they revealed to him, nutrition, healing, based on what they supposedly told him. But then, as I said earlier, what about all the aliens that he and others contacted and, you know, trained? Like, shouldn't they all still be here? Like, where did they go? Why aren't they helping us more? We sure could use it now. And again, like, why did all this happen here at that time? There were, if you don't know about this, like, there were other UFO sightings in New Jersey in the 60s. Some people might have heard about that. Like, there was a major set of those over Wanacue Reservoir in 1966 that eventually what people started calling the Roswell of the Ramapos. So you can look that up. And, you know, similar kinds of claims. Then, you know, another question, like, as I said earlier, where did all the witnesses go? He mentions a whole lot of people in his book, and, you know, there were probably lots more. You know, there's people that he doesn't name that he met along the way or was introduced to by the aliens as other contactees. So where did they go? You know, what are they doing? Why did their accounts of the contacts stop? And why don't we have other accounts? Like, how come he's the only one who saw and went on the saucers? When, like, if, you know, if these things were landing over on West Main Street and up in Long Valley at some regularity, how come nobody else saw it and didn't talk about it? So, you know, and how come no normal people saw these things? You know, as I talked about, like, Highbridge, in at the time when he was describing these events, Highbridge was rocking. You know, the bars were open, the restaurants, are trains, all hours. You could, you know, there was a train going through at, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning heading out to Scranton. You know, surely some hovering weird lights in the sky right off of Main Street would have been seen by somebody else. Nobody did, apparently. Some older folks have told me how that when they were in high school, they used to skip doing homework and go sit in their car down on 513 across from Gronsky's, waiting for the saucers to come. But they didn't. Or did they? I don't know. That's what I would love to hear, you know, anybody who actually has that story. And so what changed? Maybe there was just too much easy communication, that, you know, you could just find out what was going on, you know, anytime. Cold War reality, possible war, made all this seem kind of quaint and unimportant, you know, when, you know, we're all hiding under our desks, you know, after the Cuban Missile Crisis. I don't know. There's lots of research to be done on this, I think. That, like, the why, not just to add to the story and, you know, the facts of people's accounts, but, you know, like, the why of it. So, I'd love to talk to folks who lived in town at the time or who knew him or who heard stories from their friends and families. And
David, we have a question, if you wanted to take a question from Brian.
Yep, I'm just about done. I have one more.
Okay.
Word to say, which is really, you know, I'm just asking for folks to reach out and, you know, let's find out more about this. Let's record this. You know, it's a fascinating chapter in High Bridge history. So thanks everybody for coming, and I hope that this was interesting and maybe you learned some stuff. So yeah, I'll try to take a few questions. I'm not sure how many answers I'm going to have, but I'll do that. So okay. If you want to put that question in the chat, you know.
I'm not able to unmute him.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe he can type it into the chat.
Yeah.
People kind of forgot like how to see the chat if you can't see it. If you mouse, so no, for some people it'll be the top of the screen, other people it'll be the bottom of the screen, you know, where the control panel is. Over on the right where there's three dots and it says more, if you mouse over those three dots, it'll at the top of that little menu, it says chat. So that'll bring up the chat and you can type it in down at the bottom. Yeah, good question. actually, let's go back to that. Wait a minute. Let me just share that that image. Where is it? Hold on. One second. All right. There we go. Hold on. Yeah, you're talking about this one. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of questions like that. There's, again, it sort of seems like if you read the books, there are lots of little details like that, you know, about the technology where it sort of seems like, huh, did he see that movie? Or like, where did he get that idea? I don't know. It's unclear. The Allagash incident. No, well, I don't know what that is. Let's see. Are we going to post the recording? Yes. We'll probably do a little editing of it, but I think we're going to end up putting it on the Highbridge. You know, Highbridge Town website. We have a section there on Highbridge history, which we're in the process of kind of revisiting and re-upping, and we'll put it up there somehow. Oh, thanks for the great presentation. Thank you. You're welcome. Battlestar Galactica. That's my brother Ted. No, I have not walked the grounds where his house is, but I want to do that. Actually, you know, it's on private property. So, actually the committee just sort of made a contact with the folks down there. And so I hope to be able to do that. I would love to get some current pictures. It would be great to take some pictures, you know, from the same angles, like that amazing picture of the babysitter girl, sitting, leaning against the tree next to the house, looking at the town. Like, what does that look like now? You probably can't even see it. You know, it's probably covered with trees and, you know, all the banks there and the rest of Jenny Jump and all that stuff, you know. Why the aliens took on Aryan? No, I don't know. The question was, you had hinted at some reasons why the aliens took on Aryan appearance. So, some cultural historians speculate that it's actually coming from that movie, from The Day the Earth Stood Still. I mean, I'm not going to get into, you know, like Aryan theory in U.S. history, which of course is very long and tortured and, you know, not something to be proud of in many ways, but you know, a lot of the sort of the cultural touchstones seem to be coming like from that movie. So when they were bringing up, apparently the story goes when it drove off through it. I don't know if everybody sees this. Keith from the NJAA observatory up at Torhees. When they were bringing the huge dome for our observatory up the hill, apparently the story goes that a woman drove off the road when she saw a dome coming over the hill. That's great. Actually, you know, that's a connection that I'd be curious to hear about, because, you know, if you think about it, I mean, if you know anything about the Voorhees Observatory, for folks that aren't from there, you know, and you can go to their website and read the history and see all those great pictures of them building it. It was being built, you know, while some of this stuff was happening. You know, and a lot of the guys that were members at the time, and it would be surprising to me if they didn't know, you know, that this was going on, you know, and they were, you know, presumably like scientists, sort of, you know, amateur scientists anyway. So like, what did they think about this? You know, I don't know if any of them are still around to tell the story, but it would be interesting to know. Are there any connections to Native American sites and the locations where aliens made contact in New Jersey? I do not know. I have heard some of those stories. One of them that I've heard a number of times is that High Bridge is a portal, and that the waterfall in particular is a portal. And I'm not sure exactly what that means, but that it has been for, you know, for millennia, I suppose. Sort of begs the question, though, if it's the waterfall, you know, the waterfall is artificial and there hasn't always been a waterfall there. Somebody built that waterfall. And before that, you know, before T. Hunt could tell me when, like the 1840s or thereabouts, I think, was when the first dam was built there. Before that, the water just ran right through, you know, it was a wild river. So was there a portal there? I don't know. I'm sure you could find, you know, more other sources for information about the Native American stuff. It is kind of interesting. I know a couple of years ago, you know, we had a presentation. I forget the gentleman's name, on the Native American tool making site in Asbury, which was quite amazing how Asbury along the river there was, along the Musinetcong, was like a factory for Native American tool makers, and you know, stone was brought there from all over the East Coast, like all the way up to Maine, specific types of stone to make particular kinds of tools. And like the guys who, you know, it was almost like, you know, the stone Taylor Wharton, like those guys, those Native Americans, they were like, they really knew how to make tools out of stone. So anyway. Okay, well, about the dam, that's news to me. Send me info on these things, you know, to that events at Highbridge email. And again, I'll ask again, you know, for any of the natives who you know, who might have relatives, or you heard stories from, you know, from your dad or your grandmother or whatever, about Howard Menger, and or even, you know, I recounted a couple of those stories that I heard from people where, you know, somebody said their dad, you know, used to go drinking beer up on Hell Mountain looking for the saucers. Like, do you know anybody that did that? It'd be interesting to know. It'd also be interesting to know, like, again, like what people in town thought about this guy, because, you know, he was famous and he was walking around town. So people knew him, you know, did they like him? Did they resent this? Like, what did they, you know, did it like bring shame on the town? You know, what, I think we're maybe we'll call it a night. I'm kind of talked out, but I hope everybody had an interesting time and, you know, maybe learned some things. As I said, there's lots to still to learn about this fellow and these times around town. So.